I'm Megan Sims, and I'm the collection manager for Vertebrate Paleontology at the University of Kansas. So we have fossils, which are, for the most part, extinct animals that are no longer living, all through time and from all over the world. And we also have representatives of all the major groups of vertebrates, so mammals, amphibians, reptiles, fishes, and birds. We have three different facilities where our collection is stored, and today I'm in one of those three facilities. It's our largest by square feet. It has more of the standard modern museum storage, so closed cases, compact shelving that moves, that allows us to have more specimens in a smaller amount of space. So, like I said, we have representatives of every group. In this facility, we have our entire fish collection, many of our Pleistocene mammals, which is the Ice Age, and a lot of dinosaur specimens as well that I'll talk about later. But I'll start off by talking about some of our fishes, mainly sharks. One of the most extensive parts of our fish collection are sharks. We have representative specimens from many different taxa, many different times, and from all over the world. So here's a small representation of the diversity of sharks in the collection. We have bigger specimens from more recently in time, from the Miocene, that may have been predators of things like whales. Then we have sort of more traditional sharks that may have been feeding on fish. And then we have sort of unusual, what we call pavement-toothed sharks, which were grinding up things like mollusks. And then we have a shark that had a really unusual spiral jaw, and we actually don't really understand how that was used or why it had it. Typically, teeth are the first and sometimes only parts of the body that fossilize because they are covered with enamel, which is the hardest substance in an organism's body. But sometimes we will get parts of the skeleton or even trace fossils, which aren't parts of the body itself, but evidence that the animal was there. So here we have some really unusual specimens of shark vertebrae. They have been compressed, so they used to be wider. And shark body fossils are really unusual because sharks have a cartilaginous skeleton. So their skeleton is actually not made of bone like ours is, and like many fish. And cartilage can't fossilize as well as bone. So typically, the only thing that's left from a shark are their teeth. But we do have many specimens here at KU that preserve parts of its body. We also have some trace fossils from sharks. This is an example of a very rare one. You can see here that we have a model. This is an egg case from a shark. So you can see that it's bulbous in the center, it tapers out toward the end, and it has a spiral pattern around the outside. It might be difficult to see, but this is a nodule from here in Douglas County, where Lawrence is. And this is a fossilized egg case from a shark that dates all the way back to the Pennsylvanian. And we also, in the collection, have many coprolites from fishes. So, a coprolite is a fossilized piece of remains from inside the intestines in the colon of an animal. You can see that it has ridges here that represent the ridges inside the intestine of this fish. It tapers with a conical end, which is where it was pinched off. And this one even has tiny bones, which are the black specks, of probably the other fish that it was eating. Like the egg case that I just talked about, it was found inside a nodule here in Douglas County, Kansas. We have hundreds of nodules just like that in the collection,
and that's the only one that has an egg case inside, but the others have parts of the skull and sometimes brain cases from a different kind of bony fish. There was a group in France in the 70s and 80s that studied those nodules from our collection. We shipped hundreds of them to France. They studied them. Some students wrote dissertations about them. And for a couple of specimens that were interesting, they took slides of those specimens. Essentially, they cut them up into slices and encased each slice in a separate slide. So this specimen total had 1,400 slides. They did this so that they could see the internal structure of the specimen. This happens to be a brain case from that bony fish. And you can see the red portion that's highlighted or dyed. So like I said, they would do this to see the internal structure because previously they could only see the external portion of that brain case. And sometimes they would also do it to reconstruct things in 3D if the specimen had been found compressed or flattened. Today, we do the same process, but we don't have to cut up the specimen or use any destructive technique like this. We would CT scan a specimen, and the computer will take photos that represent each of these physical slides. So we end up with slices and a series of photographs that we can then put together to reconstruct the specimen or see the internal structure.
So these are all jacketed dinosaur bones from the late Cretaceous of New Mexico, from the Fruitland-Kirtland Formation. It looks like we've got a femur, part of a jaw, and a few other big limb bones. This is a project and a site that was excavated by KU teams from the 60s throughout the 80s to 90s. And then we abandoned that project. It has recently been picked up by a team at the Denver Museum of Nature and Science. So some of their people have come to look at this collection and sort of see what we already have. And as they're working out in the field collecting more from this site for their collection, they're going to continue to come back here, work with us, and look more at this collection to compare what we found. Another large part of our collection are Pleistocene mammals, mainly bison because they were really numerous during the Pleistocene, but we have collections both from a site in Wyoming called Natural Trap Cave that I'll talk more about later, and also the Kansas River right here in town. You can see that we have, even within bison, a large diversity of both male and female, juvenile and adult, and many different species. The biggest of which is this, which is a single horn from a bison called bison latifrons. Many people come to KU to study our Pleistocene collection. One, because it's so big, and two, because we have many representatives from different sites. So they can test specimens from both sites to compare things about their ecology, their age, their migration patterns, if they've changed where they've lived over time. So we have many specimens that have been DNA tested or tested for radiocarbon dating to answer those questions. The largest single part of our collection in BP is from the site called Natural Trap Cave that I mentioned earlier. It's a Pleistocene site in Wyoming that was actually a pit in the ground with an opening at surface level. And during the Pleistocene, through glacial and interglacial periods, every kind of animal that was living during the Pleistocene would fall into the pit and be trapped and not be able to get back out. So we have everything from mammoths to bison to American cheetahs, wolves, snakes, lizards, frogs, birds, everything. And it also is really unique because it has the ability to be dated very precisely. Part of this is because the fossils are preserved exceptionally well, since conditions are more mild and more steady in a cave environment versus being out in the open on the surface. So when they went into the cave originally, they sectioned off a grid, and so each square had a designation, and then within each of those, they could also test each level going down into the ground. So they would collect specimens from each quadrant and level and bring them back in bags like this, marked with that locality information. We would process them here, so give each of them a catalog number, record all of the locality data, and then we could give them labels, put them in storage into a drawer such as this.